If I've heard it once, I've heard it a thousand times. My trouble is from parasites. I'm certain I need to do a parasite cleanse. What say you, Dr. Gundry? Well, that's what this is about. Let's talk about parasites. Now, parasites have been around ever since we've been around. Parasites are associated with just about any creature that you can imagine. And parasites can be really mischievous. Malaria is caused by a parasite. Toxoplasmosis is caused by a parasite. Liver flukes are caused by parasites. And tapeworms are parasites. And I could go on and on. On the other hand, there are many more microscopic and macroscopic parasites that can invade our gut and can cause temporary and or permanent mischief. That's the difference of what we're going to talk about today. Parasites, as the name implies, take advantage of their host. They take away, they give nothing back. They live off the largesse of the host. We, on the other hand, are home to commensal organisms or symbiotic organisms. We give them something, usually in the form of food, and they give us something back in the form of compounds like short-chain fatty acids, like butyrate, for an example, or in the form of gaso-messengers. So parasites, bad. Symbiotes, commensals, good. The difference is knowing who's who and whether they're actually the problem. So parasites are not considered part of your normal gut flora. With a couple of exceptions, there are most likely a few worms, nematodes, that may be part of our normal intestinal flora. Now, I say that most worms are not part of our normal flora. I trained at the Medical College of Georgia in Georgia, and we would routinely see children infected with what were called hookworms. Long ago, pork was infected, pigs were infected with a parasite called trichomonas, which could have devastating effects on us. These are parasites that can invade through our gut and actually get into our airways in the form of hookworms, into our bloodstream, and cause long-term damage. But there are a few nematodes that may actually be beneficial in our gut. And there are interesting studies of people with really profound allergies and or autoimmune diseases who have purposely treated themselves with intestinal nematodes, like pinworms, and noted that their allergic reactions improved or their autoimmune diseases improved. One of my patients routinely imports worms from Thailand, which he swallows to balance his intestinal health. Do I recommend that? No. Is it harming him? Doesn't seem to be, but we are watching. So where do parasites come from? Well, mostly they come from contaminated water or from contaminated food. Most often, it's in the soil or in the water where these plants are grown. Many times, these parasites are transferred by poor hand washing, people who are picking them in the fields, or even in the food preparation. Many of them are innocent bystanders of some of our most prized foods, like, for instance, lettuces. Giardia, which is one of the most common parasites that I see giving problems with people, are usually foodborne, oftentimes in salads. Now, away from the United States, parasites are still a big deal. Tapeworms. I've had patients acquire tapeworms and pass tapeworms. Liver flukes, particularly in Southeast Asia. Giardia, as I mentioned before, is rampant in tropical conditions. Now, before we go on and why these guys are interesting and what we do about it, If you like what you're hearing so far, make sure to like us, subscribe, and tell your friends about us so they can benefit from this content as well. Okay, so what do parasites do? Well, parasites are looking for food, and they want to compete for the food that we eat. Other parasites want to actually bind onto our intestinal wall, like a tapeworm or other worms, and just be bathed in all the food that we eat, that we are digesting, and they get to eat that free of charge. Many of them can damage the wall of the gut, leading to increased intestinal permeability. Now, certain parasites release toxins and enzymes that actually weaken the tight junctions in the gut wall. I routinely test for parasites in all of my patients with their gut zoomer test. And this looks at over 100 different parasites, from single-cell organisms to multicellular organisms like worms, for example. And I can tell you that 95% of my patients with leaky gut do not have parasites. And the ones that do are by far the common garden variety parasites like Giardia. And quite frankly, Giardia is number one in all the parasites I see in my patients. Bottom line, parasites can contribute to leaky gut, but if you're having a health issue, if you're having fatigue, if you have an autoimmune disease, don't assume parasites are to blame. Okay, so how do you test for parasites? Here's the bad news. Traditionally, doctors are trained to send a stool specimen for ova and parasite testing. In fact, just this last week, I had one of my patients develop some very impressive diarrhea, very loose stools multiple times per day, often watery. And it not only came out of the blue, but it persisted for about 3 weeks. And we tried some of my usual tricks, and the tricks really weren't working. So eventually, she said, I give up. I'm going to go to the emergency room, and they're going to find out what's wrong. I said, hey, great. She went to the emergency room. They tested her for stool for ova and parasites. And I told her, I said, they're not going to find anything. She said, I got to find out. I said, fine, get the test. And she said, you were right. They didn't find anything. And I said, look, I've been doing this for 30 years, and I can tell you that most stool for ova and parasites do not find parasites. Because, number one, a lot of these parasites have to lay eggs, if you will, and you're not going to see those eggs if they're not actively producing eggs, ova. And most of these parasites are very microscopic, and you're not going to see them well in a stool. So what can you do? Well, luckily, with the advent of RNA and DNA stool tests, like the gut zoomer done by Vibrant Wellness, we can now actually identify all these organisms by their RNA and or DNA signature. And each of these organisms has its own signature. So we don't actually have to look for these organisms per se. We just have to read the RNA and DNA in the stool and identify who's there. And that test has revolutionized looking for parasites. And because that does look for all these possible parasites, I can tell you unequivocally that most of us with leaky gut, with autoimmune diseases, it's not the parasites that are the culprit behind all this. Now, occasionally they are there. So if you suspect, particularly if you've traveled the world or traveled even to Mexico or the Caribbean or South America, and you come back feeling different, by all means, get a full RNA DNA examination of your stool. You're probably going to find that you'll be listened to by a functional medicine doctor more than a conventional doctor. Because quite frankly, conventional doctors, even GI doctors, are not trained in this. And so it's not their fault that they're using an antiquated test. The newer tests are far more useful. Okay, so what do you do when you do find these parasites? Well, the good news, and the good news for me, is that a lot of these natural treatments really do work. And I've been pleasantly surprised that the age-old natural treatments for parasites, for the most part, are very effective. So some of the things that I frequently recommend: wormwood, oregano oil, garlic, berberine, and D-limonene all work in combination. And sometimes they're all in one product or another. Now, there are pharmaceutical options. I get a chuckle that ivermectin, which became popular during COVID, is approved by the FDA as a dewormer. And it's a really effective dewormer. Now, the interesting thing about ivermectin is that ivermectin is sold in most feed supply stores, horse supply stores, as a horse dewormer. And certainly during COVID, some of my more clever patients who wanted to use it as an antiviral ended up going to feed stores and buying out all the ivermectin. And you can still see ivermectin on the shelves in a feed store if you want it. The reason FDA approved ivermectin as a dewormer is that ivermectin is an incredibly potent mitochondrial uncoupler. It's so potent that it actually works like 2,4-dinitrophenol, which was the decoupler discovered during the World Wars. It works so well as a mitochondrial uncoupler that the worm stops making ATP and dies. Now, the reason they approved it is because ivermectin is not absorbed in our GI tract. They knew how potent ivermectin was as a decoupler, but also knew in studies that it couldn't be absorbed from the human intestinal tract. So that's why they approved it. Just keep that in mind. Ivermectin is actually a really cool anti-cancer agent, but we can't absorb it. So other pharmaceutical options. Sometimes in really stubborn cases, we've got to use a parasite-specific antibiotic that specifically interrupts the cell cycle of parasites. The good news is, in the last 5 years, thanks to these new tests, I've only had to resort to a pharmaceutical option in one patient who really was resistant to every trick we had for Giardia. And again, Giardia is by far the most common parasite that I see people obtaining from time to time, particularly when traveling to foreign countries. So the long story short, if you're thinking of a parasite cleanse, think about the products that I just mentioned, which are effective. But before you think about doing that, the odds are your issue is not coming from a parasite. And all the hype that you see on the internet is not backed up by actual stool gut testing in the proper way, looking for parasites the way they should be sought out. More amazing episodes just like this one. Watch now. Diquat is so dangerous that it's been banned in all countries except, you guessed it, the United States.